Have you ever wondered what are the long-term effects of sleep deprivation? We're going to start with the short-term effects and then we'll wrap into that as well. Everybody knows that sleep is important. Some people may not know is that different stages of sleep do different things for us. And sometimes we can become sleep deprived even if we're sleeping. Because we're missing out on some of those deeper stages of sleep. We've addressed that in some of the other videos. The quick version is that our stage 4 sleep, or the deepest stage of sleep, is restorative. It kind of reboots or cleanses the machine a little bit so that we can function at a better level. If we miss out on that stage of sleep, we tend to have an increase of anxiety and stress. Interestingly enough, anxiety and stress tend to make us miss out on more of our sleep, and we get into this nasty cycle sometimes. What about other forms of sleep deprivation? You already know from your own experience that if you don't get enough sleep, and if that continues over a period of time, you start to notice some effects. Probably the most obvious are the short-term effects. So let's talk about what some of those short-term effects are first. I'm thinking the most obvious one, and the one that we most often notice ourselves, is a decrease in our attentiveness and performance and our ability to stay engaged in what it is that we're doing during the day, because we get kind of drowsy. I've looked at some of the reported numbers on this, and losing even as much as an hour and a half off of our regular sleep schedule can decrease our performance by up to 30%. Kind of along the same lines, that decrease in attentiveness and ability to focus can start to impact our memory and our cognitive functioning. So I guess the short version there is we're not as smart as we would be if we're getting all of our good sleep. Have you ever noticed also that if you don't get enough sleep, you're not as pleasant to be around? You can check with other people in your home if you want, and they'll probably tell you this, but you've noticed this with other people too. If they don't get enough sleep, they might be more grumpy. So this starts to put a strain on relationships. That can also result in more conflicts or moodiness or arguments or disagreements, all of the fun things that come when we're not quite on top of our own game. All of these things affect our experience of our life. Sometimes we call this quality of life. Quality of life is just my subjective sense of how good is my life. It tends to go down if we're losing out on our sleep. And again, we're still talking about short-term effects. What about this one? Maybe an obvious one, but it's actually tied to sleep. Have you seen the signs out on the freeway that say, "Don't drive drunk"? No, they don't say that anymore, do they? Although that's kind of a duh. Don't drive drowsy. Why? Because drowsy drivers cause accidents. I actually found this statistic as I was preparing for the video. The National Highway Traffic Safety Administration estimates, conservatively it says, that each year drowsy driving is responsible for at least 100,000 automobile crashes, 71,000 injuries, and 1,500 fatalities. Drowsy driving. These are all short-term effects of the lack of sleep. So what about the long-term effects? Now this is where it gets really scary, because it's going to impact our health and our well-being in a much bigger way if it becomes long-term. Some of the ones that have been listed include high blood pressure, heart problems, like heart attack or heart failure, stroke, obesity, because really you're not giving your body the chance to reset some of the things that actually help you to metabolize the things that are coming into your body. Psychiatric problems, we've seen problems with mood, for example, and memory and attention. ADHD is something that is diagnosed very frequently in children. How much of that might have to do with sleep disturbance? Maybe some is what we ought to be thinking. And we've already talked about some of the other things like mental impairment, increased risk of accidents, things like that. Sleep is pretty darn important. We need to pay attention to that. I've even seen some sources that are comparing it to alcohol problems as a health concern. That's pretty high level stuff. So what can we do about it? I think there's a couple of really basic things we can do to improve our sleep. The most basic thing that I can suggest here is called sleep hygiene. It's kind of like dental hygiene. You know, you brush your teeth, you take good care of your teeth, and then your teeth are gonna be around to help take care of you. In the same way, if we take good care of our sleeping and we look at our sleeping habits and the context around our sleep, we can improve our sleep efficiency and make sure that we're getting enough sleep. So in terms of sleep hygiene, the first thing that I would encourage you to take a look at is your schedule, okay? Are you actually getting to bed at a decent time? And some of the research suggests that your time for waking up being a consistent time, that's also a thing that you can do to improve your sleep patterns. So take a look at your schedule. Are you getting enough? And most of the opinions out there are saying anywhere from 6 to 10 hours for adults is about what we need to shoot for. And that varies depending on health concerns and other life factors. Adolescents, incidentally, tend to need a little more sleep than adults do. They've still got a developing brain, and that sleep helps to support that brain development. So take a look at the schedule, make sure that you're giving yourself the time you need to sleep. Now look at the physical environment. Is it dark enough? If you've got a lot of light coming in, light will enter your eye even through a closed eyelid, and it will trigger in the retina something that's called the retinal thalamic response. It's tied into your thalamus, it's tied into your brain chemistry. Okay, you wanna have it dark, not just because it's easier to go to sleep, but because that alters your chemistry a little bit. So having a dark room, there are some suggestions that a few degrees cooler is helpful rather than warmer. Quiet is important to good sleep hygiene. Now, you might be used to, for example, I had some clients who said, well, I can't get to sleep unless the TV's on. There's probably a lot of reasons for that. Most of them are behavioral and conditioned. If you can get yourself to sleep in a quiet, dark room instead of one where there's some ambient light or noise, you're probably gonna get a little better sleep. And that sometimes takes a little practice and training, but quiet is important. Comfortable. Do you see how some of these are just kind of obvious? But you wanna have a comfortable bed or mattress, a comfortable pillow. If it's not comfortable, you're gonna be kind of wrestling with that thing all night long or tossing and turning. Can be kind of disruptive to your sleep. A lot of these new fitness trackers will actually track your sleep, and you'll get some information you didn't even have before. So if you wear one of those to bed, you might get some baseline information that will help you to know, how many times am I awake? How does this match with the baselines? And you can kind of do a little self-assessment of, how good a sleep am I getting? And if it's lower than it should be, if you're not quite hitting the baselines, you might want to look at some of these sleep hygiene issues and see what you can do to address that. In addition to that, there's some other basic things to keep in mind. Alcohol tends to disrupt sleep patterns. The more you can limit your alcohol intake, the better sleep you're going to have, which is counterintuitive to some people because they'll use alcohol to help them get to sleep. Well, that may be true, but it may also be disrupting some of your levels of sleep that you need to really reboot and refresh your mind. So staying away from alcohol, the research shows that caffeine tends to disrupt some of those sleep patterns. Caffeine has a half-life of 5 to 6 hours, meaning if you ingest the caffeine, 5 to 6 hours later, you're still gonna have about half of that potency in your system. The recommendation coming from some of the research is that you limit your caffeine intake to less than 200 milligrams before noon, assuming that you're on a regular sleep pattern. And then the last one that has been coming up in the research more lately is blue light. You can go do some self-research on this. The blue light that comes from the screens that we watch, like the television, for example, or the tablet or the smartphone, tends to be higher in the blue wavelengths, and that wavelength or that area in the spectrum tends to activate our brain more than allow it to calm down. So limiting our screen time, especially before bed, is an important thing in limiting the amount of blue light that might be creeping into the bedroom. Those are some simple things that you can do in terms of sleep hygiene, and maybe we can get ahead of some of these effects, both short-term and long-term, of sleep deprivation. So now we know how important sleep is. You're gonna wanna go get a little bit of sleep, but first you might wanna watch that next video. It's awesome.